Hi everybody, this is Albert from the Center for High Performance Computing at the University of Utah, and in this tutorial we will be talking about Slurm batch jobs and batch scripting. So the first question is, when should you be using the batch system? Well, you should use the batch system when you have a large job that is running in parallel, that is heavy duty computation, anything that is really high performance computing. And so to use the batch system, you have to really have a grasp on scripting. Now, there will be another scripting tutorial that you can watch, but we're going to go through the basics of what you need to put into a batch script in order to run on the batch system here. So the question is, what goes into a batch script? The first thing that you put into a batch script under a Slurm system is a set of SBatch directives. SBatch directives tell the scheduler what to use in terms of number of nodes, how many cores per node, how many tasks across all of those nodes, the account and the partition that you want to use, how long you're going to run for, all of those pieces of information that are useful for telling the scheduler what your job looks like. Now, once you have your SBatch directives set up, you need to set up your environment. So at CHPC, what that would entail is loading some modules, maybe setting up some additional path variables so that you can run a specific program that you wrote yourself. Basically, setting up your environment so that you can run your job. Now, a lot of jobs will also need a scratch directory to run from, and so usually it's good practice to set up your scratch directory in your batch script as well before you run that. In addition to this, oftentimes you'll want to be copying your data to scratch. This is especially true of programs that have heavy I/O loads. If you anticipate having lots of writes, then you should be really doing your writing in scratch. If you're doing something smaller, lightweight, that isn't going to impact the file servers that much, then you can run from your home directory, but this is generally not recommended. Now, obviously, if you're running a batch script, you want to run your job, and you want to run it in parallel with MPI if you need to. And so, obviously, you want to make sure that you run your job in your batch script, otherwise you're not really doing anything. Now, along with step number four here, you want to make sure that if you have data that you're writing to scratch, that you copy it to a safe location. Now, this could be to your home directory, this could be to your group space. Either way, if you're writing to scratch, make sure that you copy from scratch so that you don't lose data in scratch, because the scratch file servers at CHPC are scrubbed after 30 days. Finally, if your program writes any temporary files or if you have leftover scratch data, then you should remove those so that you can be a good citizen. And so these are the things that you need to put into a batch script in order to make that run well. So now I'm going to show you an example script, a very simple one that does some actual work for me. So if we do an ls, you can see that we have this run QE slurm that you may have seen in our basic slurm tutorial. So I'm going to show you this script. So here we have our script. Now the question is, what do you put into this? Now, like I was saying before, you want to put in a whole bunch of SBatch directives. But before you do that, you want to make sure that you put in your shebang. So here we can see that this is a bash script. If you're running a bash script, you want to make sure to use bash. If you're using C shell, you want to make sure to use TCSH. Either way, if you don't put this in here, then Slurm will not be able to determine how to run this script. It'll only say, here's this weird script that I don't know what to do with. Now, the SBatch directive for time is straightforward. You just do dash dash time equals the time that you are running. This is seconds, minutes, and hours. This directive shows the number of nodes. This one determines the number of tasks. Now, the number of tasks is spread out across however many nodes you have. So if you have 16 tasks on one node, then that'll be 16 tasks per node. If you have 16 tasks but two nodes, then you'll have 8 tasks per node. Now you can also tune this with different parameters. For example, we have a parameter that is number of tasks per node, and you can also ask for different processors per node. Those are all detailed on our Slurm webpage, but for the most part, using end tasks is straightforward. Here we have the account and partition, and then here we have this dash O flag, which tells the scheduler what the output name of your standard output is. So you can imagine that if this script had errors in it, then you would want to be writing this to standard output somehow so that you could see those errors. And so using the dash O flag is how you do this. Now this right here is name. You can write whatever name you want. I have this with a prefix QE dash because this is a quantum espresso job. The suffix here, the percent sign J, is a special syntax for Slurm, and it only works in Slurm, which will use the job number in place of something else. So if you wanted to append the job number to your output name, then this is how you would do that. Now the next step is obviously to set up your environment, and that's what I do in this section of the script. So I set up some convenience variables. I set the name of my input file, which is actually just a prefix in this instance. I have my data directory where my data is being stored, and then I have a scratch directory specified because Quantum Espresso needs a scratch. Now in addition to this, I also load the correct modules in order to run this. Now when you're using modules, I recommend that when you use batch scripts that you start out by doing a module purge. This starts you out with a clean environment and it makes things more predictable when you actually get there. This is because Slurm will carry over your environment variables for your current environment. So then we do the module load, we do Intel IMPI QE because that's the order that we need. And this sets up the environment that I want to be running in. Now, the variable setup here is totally up to you. You don't have to do this necessarily, but this is simply just convenience. Now, I do need to make sure that this directory exists, so you can do this with a makedir command. The dash p will make sure that the directory is created regardless of whether or not the parent directories are existing. And then obviously we just have the scratch, which refers back to this variable. Now here we see that I've written this comment, copy data to scratch here if you need to. With Quantum Espresso I don't actually need to copy my data to scratch because I have a very limited amount of writing that I do to my output. Most of it is handled by Quantum Espresso, and this scratch directory which I specified is in the input file for Quantum Espresso, so I don't have to worry about it. But this is where you would perform that copy if you needed to do so. Here we have my execution of the job, which is simply just an MPI run. Since I've loaded the IMPI module, MPI run is already detected. And then I do the number of processes, which you use the Slurm end task variable to specify the number of tasks if you want to do this. For Slurm, you don't actually need to put this here, but I put it there for the sake of sanity to make sure that I know what's going on. And then here we run Quantum Espresso, which is the name of the program, the input file, and then the output file. Now, a good practice to adopt with your output files is that if you're writing an output file and you have control over what you can name it, that you use the Slurm job ID variable to tag that variable with the job ID. This is useful to you so that you can keep your input files independent of each other, and also so that when you are having trouble with jobs that you can easily find the job ID and tell us, the staff people at center, the CHPC center, to give us the job number so that we can help you with that. Now you have an alternative to running MPI run, and it can be somewhat complicated to run, but you can actually just use srun. Slurm is aware of MPI distributions, and a lot of the ones that we use at CHPC will allow you to use srun in lieu of MPI run. And so there are some things that depend from MPI to MPI that are useful for running srun, but you can use srun if you so desire. Now, the final step that you want to make sure that you do if you've copied data to Scratch is to copy data from Scratch. Now, you can copy to your home directory, you can copy to your group space, you just have to make sure that you have enough space to make that copy. And then finally, the last step is to clean up your Scratch directories and other temporary files, which in this case, I want to clean up my Scratch directory because I don't need to keep the stuff there, so that you can clean up the environment and make sure to free up space on Scratch areas for other users. So now I'm going to quickly show you an example of this. In my directory, I have my runqe.slurm. Here's my input file. So if I do sbatch, then I submit my job. And if I do an sq, you can see that my job is now running. Now, I'm expecting two output files here. One of them is the standard output, and the other is the output. And you'll notice that even though my job isn't running, that I'm not seeing this. This is because there's a slight delay between the file systems being written to and then updating on the client. So if you don't immediately see output files, it's because the file servers are just taking a little time to make sure that you can see those. And here we can see now that I actually have my two output files. Here's the output that I expect to see for my program, which is just the useful output. If I look at it real quickly, you can see that it's run, and that the job is done. It didn't take very long to run, only about 14 seconds, which is expected. And then we also have the standard output file from the script. Now, whether or not you see anything in that output file is up to your program. We see here that there's no output in my program, which means my script worked right and there are no errors, but it just simply depends on what your script looks like. And with that, that's everything I have to show you. I hope you enjoyed this tutorial and that you learned something. If you have questions, you can email us at issues@chcc.utah.edu, or you can visit us at our offices in INSCC 405. Thanks for watching!